Good afternoon from Christian Medical College, Vellore, and a warm welcome to all participants of PULSE, those who are in the CMC main campus, peripheral campuses, and in the mission hospitals. My name is Anand Zakaria from the Department of Medicine, and I represent the training team of the COVID Command Center. The COVID-19 pandemic has been a challenge to medical education. How do we upskill a large workforce of doctors from different departments and specialities to take care of COVID-19 patients to reduce morbidity, mortality, and suffering in a rapidly evolving area of medicine and in a pandemic situation? The training team at the COVID Command Center is using different approaches, including the handbook in COVID-19 management, online case-based learning module of 5 cases, weekly online town hall discussions. Today is the first session of COVID Pulse, or COVID Public Lecture Series, open to all staff and students at CMC and in the Mission Network. The purpose of COVID Pulse is to provide clinicians with an up-to-date knowledge on integral aspects of COVID-19 management in order to inform clinical care and improve patient outcomes. To bring together doctors involved in the clinical care of patients with COVID-19 so that questions regarding the feasibility of the intervention and barriers to its implementation across diverse case scenarios are examined and addressed, and to provide ideas for further innovation and help clinicians design and refine protocols in the context of available resources. So far, we have planned 5 lectures which will occur on a weekly basis, starting with oxygen therapy and then going on to anticoagulation, pharmacotherapy, ICU care, and end-of-life care. The inaugural session today is moderated by Dr. Binila Chako, Professor of the Division of Critical Care. She has spearheaded the expansion of the ICUs in the COVID pandemic, which has close to 75 beds now. The talk today is delivered by Dr. Barney Isaac, Associate Professor in Pulmonary Medicine. Barney is an undergraduate and postgraduate from CMC. He received further training in Thurrock University Hospital in UK. Barney has been actively involved in setting up and running a new ICU, the K-ICU, which provides only non-invasive ventilation for COVID-19 patients. We have chosen this inaugural lecture for obvious reasons, because of the importance of oxygen therapy and NIV in reducing deaths, and this is a rapidly evolving field. So very happy to have Dr. Binila and Dr. Barney to be with you this afternoon to share their knowledge and their experience. I'm handing over to Dr. Binila.
Good evening to one and all. Thank you, Dr. Anand, for giving a succinct overview of the relevance of this COVID Pulse series of lectures. Now, if you look at this topic, NIV per se has a very important role in the management of respiratory failure of diverse etiology. When I look back at the scenario 6 months ago, I still remember discussing in with Dr. Prasad and team about whether we would do NIV in ICU, and the straight answer from the entire team was no, because of I'm sure all of you are aware that NIV per se can increase the risk of aerosol generation, and we are not, in many centers across India, we are not well equipped to manage safely. We don't have negative pressure rooms to manage safely this group of patients on non-invasive ventilation. However, during the past 6 months, what we have noticed is we have actually found that patients on NIV do way better than patients on invasive ventilation. And hence it is, given the extent of involvement of COVID across India, this is indeed a very important topic for all of us to get more awareness about, to know how to tackle and troubleshoot problems. And hence, I'd like to hand over the floor to Dr. Barney to take us through this topic on oxygen therapy, awake self-proning, and non-invasive ventilation. Please feel free to put your questions in the chat box, and we will address it at the end of the talk. Over to you, Barney.
Thank you, Dr. Benila, for the introductory words, and I thank Dr. Anand and his team for spearheading the training during these times of COVID, which is of paramount importance in bringing to reality the literature that's available so that our patients get the best benefit. And I think today is one such occasion where we are opening this to not only everyone in CMC, but to other mission hospitals as well, from where we are already receiving many calls for the management of patients with COVID. So today I would like to take you through oxygen therapy, awake self proning or positioning as it's called, and non-invasive ventilation in COVID-19. And I would also be embarking from some of the experiences that we've had in the respiratory ICU in CMC. PICU, which is only 5 weeks old, started because of the need from COVID-19. I would be touching upon some physiology at the beginning, but however, we'll need to come back to it as we go along to learn several aspects of these treatments. So we'll look at some devices, some evidences here and there, which are important for us to realize why we are doing what we are doing. Some indications, contraindications, and prerequisites. Some practical aspects, tips and tricks, which you may not find in textbooks, but which are very important on a practical aspect, lessons that we've learned on the bedside and how implementing these issues on in a hospital where things may be just starting up, what are the costs involved, and so on. So the idea of NIV came to us quite a few months back when actually we wrote this article, when we realized that there was a paradigm shift in the management of COVID pneumonia from invasive ventilation and saying no to NIV, as Dr. Benila was mentioning, to finding that NIV can be safely given and in fact is more easily available, cost effective, and hence eventually may be able to save more lives, at least in the resource limited settings. So that journey went on to review some bits of physiology, which was important, particularly for COVID pneumonia. But even generally, we had to learn about the physiology of the movement of gases, which works on the fixed principle, which is the diffusion of gases across the alveolar endothelial membrane. And by the formulae which are mentioned below, what it primarily means is that it is directly proportional to the diffusion constant. The difference in the partial pressure of the gas in the alveoli to the pulmonary capillaries, the surface area, the time that is available for the diffusion to take place. And it is inversely proportional to the thickness of the membrane. So a disease process affecting the membrane would impair the diffusion of the gas, and the distance between the capillaries and the alveolar wall, if that is more, that again would impair the diffusion of gas across the alveolar endothelial membrane. And the diffusibility of oxygen is 20 times lower than that of carbon dioxide, is also to be kept in mind at this point in time. The other important aspect that we need to understand in COVID pneumonia is that when there is increased work of breathing, which is uncontrolled, that leads to what is called
SILI, that is self-inflicted lung injury, and it propagates a chain of worsening of the lung condition of the patient to progressive type 1 respiratory failure, which is hypoxemia, and then it becomes very difficult to tackle this issue. So people have in this context looked at it that if you actually have to find out the work of breathing, it requires to look at the change in manometry from the esophagus, and swings more than 15 centimeter would increase the risk of self-inflicted lung injury. But this is not practical, and often we fall back to a very non-specific marker, which is the respiratory rate, and say tachypnea is equivalent to work of breathing. And as we have realized, particularly in the management of COVID, tachypnea is multifactorial and is not sensitive to pick up work of breathing. So if you go after treating tachypnea, we may not be doing the right thing for the patient. So tachypnea is of multiple reasons in COVID. It can be because of anxiety, which can have a voluntary increase in breathing, emotions that are affected. There are stretch receptors that are there in the lung. So the pneumonitis, the ARDS stretch these receptors in the lung. Next to the capillaries, there are the J receptors, which gets stimulated. These could cause tachypnea. Then there can be irritant vagus stimuli, which can also increase the respiratory rate. So none of these are actually related to hypoxemia and direct involvement of lung in terms that we are, when we look at the patient, are trying to find out. So when there is hypoxemia, that does cause increased work of breathing, but that is only one part of the whole thing. So these investigators went on to look at some more points which are probably practically important to note. They gave ALR flaring, the prominence of the sternocleidomastoid during inspiration on palpation, and the prominence of the abdominal muscles during expiration as pointers which would indicate work of breathing. Then they plotted the respiratory rate and the work of breathing, and they found that even in tachypnea, there were a subset who did not have work of breathing. And similarly, tachypnea, not all of them had use of accessory muscles. Whereas in those who are not tachypneic also, there was use of accessory muscles. So obviously, it is not tachypnea is not a reliable marker of work of breathing, and one needs to look for more specific signs of increased work of breathing and tackle that while trying to tackle COVID pneumonia and COVID ARDS. Going on to oxygen therapy, the sources of oxygen are from oxygen cylinders, oxygen concentrators, and in big hospitals like CMC, there is oxygen stored as liquid oxygen, and then through the wall there is oxygen supply. Whichever be the oxygen source that we are using, it is very important to plan and source oxygen in advance. The reason this is important is when COVID patients get admitted in large numbers, about 1/5 of them are going to end up requiring oxygen, and a significant proportion would require increased oxygen, which means unusually there are going to be huge number of patients in our hospitals who are going to require oxygen, and if we do not plan the source of oxygen, we could run out of oxygen to provide these patients. We all know about oxygen cylinders, so I'm not going to go into that in depth. However, oxygen concentrators may be something important to know about. Oxygen concentrators work with electricity. They concentrate the oxygen from the atmosphere. They are available as single flow or dual flow. They can give up to 5 liters per minute, and some can give up to 10 liters per minute, and sometimes can be used serially, one after the other, to increase the oxygen flow. One of them would cost around 40,000 rupees. Now going on to the delivery of oxygen, they can be classified into low FiO2 delivery devices and high FiO2 delivery devices. The lower FiO2 delivery devices are the nasal prongs and the face mask, or the Hudson mask as we call it. And the high FiO2 devices are the Venturi mask, the reservoir bag, which could be non-rebreather and or partial rebreather, and the high flow nasal cannula. These are some of the delivery devices for oxygen. What we see here in the top left is the nasal prongs, which is a very common modality with which oxygen is delivered. Below here is the Venturi device, which can provide varied fixed concentrations of high flow oxygen. And here is the reservoir bag, which can be either non-rebreather or partial rebreather, and based on where the valves are placed and how the patient's inspiratory flow is, this could act as either low flow or a high flow device. Now, when we do use a nasal prong, it's a very very crude way of knowing the FiO2 when we give the give oxygen through nasal flow. But people have gone on to calculate it. And there is a rule of thumb that is used that FiO2 is 24% plus 4 multiplied by the total liters of flow minus 1. So if someone is on a 5 liter nasal cannula flow of oxygen, 5 liters per minute, 5 minus 1 is 4, 4 fours are 16, and 16 plus 24 is 40. So when you give 5 liters per minute, the patient would probably approximately be receiving 40% FiO2. But these are not possible to give beyond 6 liters, because this is dry air going in at very high force into the nose and would cause quite an amount of discomfort. So usually up to 5 to 6 liters is what is recommended through a nasal flow. Next, moving on to the Venturi devices. The Venturi devices come in varied colors. It is attached to flex tube. At the end of it is the Venturi device. It works by the principle of the Bernoulli's theorem, where when a particular flow of gas, and in this case 100% oxygen, goes through the inlet of the Venturi, it causes a negative pressure around it in these holes that we see here, and air is drawn up to it. And the way these Venturi devices are made, if through a 60% Venturi, if we give 15 liter per minute of 100% oxygen, then the patient would receive 60% FiO2. And if you are giving a 40% Venturi, 10 liter, it would be 40% FiO2, 35% would be 8 liter, and we need to change the color of the Venturi accordingly as we go down. 24% would be 2 liter per minute inflow of oxygen. Then the addition of air by the side would amount to 24% FiO2, which the patient would be receiving. Now, there are some things to understand from the response to hypoxia. Now, we did learn that increased workup breathing is a response to hypoxia. Now, tachypnea, which we see, which we often try to corroborate as a surrogate marker to that the patient is manifesting to improve oxygenation, may not be always true due to reasons we already discussed. And also, tachypnea may not always improve the oxygenation. We know that minute ventilation is the product of the tidal volume and the respiratory rate. Now, if the minute when the patient is tachypneic, if on increased respiratory rate there is no change in the minute ventilation, then the patient is taking rapid shallow breaths, which means there is a drop in the tidal volume. And the tidal volume in an airway is distributed to the anatomical dead space of the tracheobronchial tree's proximal extent and the alveolar ventilation, which goes into the alveoli and actually participates in ventilation. Now, when a patient takes rapid shallow breaths, most of the gas goes in and out is in the anatomical dead space. The alveolar ventilation in effect actually decreases and could adversely affect hypoxia. However, if a patient is hyperhypnic, which is actually increase in tidal volume, which also happens when someone is tachypneic, that is what actually improves oxygenation by increasing alveolar ventilation. Again, this tells us that we should not address tachypnea alone as a marker and go after it to correct it by increasing pressure or by increasing oxygen. We also need to understand that COVID ARDS is not primarily a problem of ventilation, but of oxygenation. It is a problem of oxygenation and increased work of breathing, if left uncorrected, would go on to have self-inflicted lung injury and the progressive damages because of that. And often we see most of our patients in our respiratory ICU have respiratory alkalosis and actually not hypercarbia. So if you actually see what are the main determinants to increase oxygenation in a patient, it is increasing the FiO2 and increasing the PEEP. Now PEEP is the end expiratory pressure, the positive pressure at the end of expiration in the alveoli, which is responsible for keeping the alveoli open and enabling exchange of oxygen and hence improve oxygenation. Now I would like to move on to some evidence on saturation targets in ARDS we should be aware of, which is to be applied in COVID as well, because if we do not follow this appropriately, we may be doing harm for a section of patients. Now what is the most appropriate target for COVID ARDS? This is, I'm talking about SpO2. Is it more than 95? Is it 92 to 95? Is it 88 to 92? While you keep pondering on that, I would like to take you on to the literature that is available. IOTA is a systematic review and meta-analysis of 25 RCTs published in The Lancet in 2018, which clearly demonstrated that there is high quality evidence to show that liberal oxygen therapy, and by that they mean more than 96% saturation as the target, increases the mortality without improving other patient important outcomes. And hence they suggested that supplemental oxygen might become unfavorable above an SpO2 of 94 to 96, and hence advised conservative administration of oxygen. So this put to rest the targets of having more than 96. Now what is left? Is 92 to 95 better, or something like 88 to 92 better, is still unanswered. There was another randomized controlled trial published in New England Journal of Medicine earlier this year, where the study randomized patients with ARDS into liberal and conservative oxygen. However, here the definition of liberal and conservative was slightly different. Those on the liberal oxygen group had a PaO2 target of 90 to 105, and the conservative oxygen group had a target of 55 to 70. That extrapolates to a saturation of liberal being more than 96 and conservative being 88 to 92. Now this study was prematurely stopped and they couldn't conclude much except to say that early exposure to conservative oxygen strategy PaO to 55 to 70 did not increase survival. But however, looking at the reason for which it was prematurely stopped was because there were 5 cases of mesenteric ischemia in the conservative oxygen group as opposed to no mesenteric ischemia in the liberal oxygen group. So there is an editorial after this in NEJM which goes on to say that probably if we target too low saturations like 88 to 92, which equates to a PaO2 of 55 to 70, there is a risk of causing the hypoxemia to go beyond its acceptable lower limit and in fact cause hypoxic tissue damage in several parts of the body. So it appears by available evidence that what is in between a saturation of 92 to 95 or a saturation of PaO2 of 70 to 90 seems what is desirable. One additional word on the oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve. On the x-axis we have the partial pressure of oxygen and on the y-axis we have the saturation of oxygen. And we know that when the saturation is about 90%, the PaO2 is about 60%. Now, the point I want to make here is that many of our patients who are not in ICU but in an intermediate care unit who are quite tachypneic do have a significant respiratory alkalosis, which actually causes caused by a decrease in PCO2 and results in an increase in pH. This actually shifts the oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve to the left. So for the same saturation of 90, they may be actually having a much lower PaO2, resulting in tissue hypoxemia. That gives another point why whenever we are doing ABG, we also probably need to check on a PaO2 range rather than be satisfied only with the saturation range. Hence, if we put all this together that we have at this moment, the targets for oxygenation would be a target of 92 to 95% saturation in all patients except those in type 2 respiratory failure, where the target would be 88 to 92%. And the target PaO2 whenever an ABG is done would be 70 to 90 millimeter of mercury, except in type 2 respiratory failure, where the target would be 55 to 70 millimeter of mercury. And the reason, obvious reason why we don't want to give more oxygen in type 2 respiratory failure is they are breathing because of their hypoxemic drive. And if we hyperoxygenate them anywhere above this, they would go into respiratory depression and more accumulation of carbon dioxide. Now, going on to the indications of oxygen in COVID is extrapolated from the same discussions we've been having in the last few slides, that when someone is having a type 1 respiratory failure, the indications of oxygen is when the saturation drops below 92% or an ABG which shows a PaO2 below 70 millimeter of mercury. In type 2 respiratory failure, this would relate to a saturation of 88% or a PaO2 of less than 55. These would be the indications when one should initiate on oxygen therapy. Now, some practical considerations while on oxygen. Now, this we actually learned at the bedside. We have a 14-bedded respiratory ICU where all our patients most of them have 3 meals a day, probably snacks in between as well. So when they are on oxygen, feeding becomes an issue, because some of them, you remove oxygen for a while, they can plummet their oxygen down without even having much symptomatic realization of the same. So we realize that when someone is on nasal prongs, or even if they're on a venturi or a mask, if we shift them onto a nasal prong up to 6 liters, you can give about 44% FiO2, and we could comfortably allow them to eat. But if they are not tolerating that and need to be on a mask, at the moment we have 2 to 3 of our patients who are on a 100% reservoir bag. If you take that, they would desaturate. Then the only way is we ask them to hold the mask with the left hand and have the foot on the right hand, remove the mask, bite, put the mask on. Remove, eat, put the mask on. And that seems to reasonably work in most of these patients. So that may be a practical take-home message to manage these patients. The second aspect that we've been keenly watching is the protection of healthcare workers when we are giving oxygen therapy. We are talking about non-invasive ventilation, but even oxygen therapy has a risk of aerosolization of the virus and be a risk for the healthcare worker. So the concept that is coming up is masking of the oxygen flow is important to decrease this risk. Now, what do I mean by that? There have been a range of studies which have looked at computational fluid dynamics, where laser beams are passed to smoke that is used as the material for observation, and they looked at how this causes aerosolization. So top right, if you see, this is a mannequin in which there was low flow oxygen given and there was no mask used. And this laser picture shows how much aerosolization takes place. And this is with a surgical mask over the same low flow, and you can appreciate how there is no aerosolization at all. and this is no oxygen at all. Even on room air, when the patient is breathing, there was so much aerosolization, and when the mask is on, there is no aerosolization. Sorry. So this is why we all wear masks. I'm sitting here talking to you wearing masks, because of this reason. Now, even with patients who are on oxygen, this risk is even more. So it's very important when we are managing COVID patients in the ward, when they are on oxygen, we need to put a surgical mask over the oxygen device. So they went on to conclude that surgical mask with oxygen delivery reduces the risk of dispersion. However, this does not obviate the need for a PPE by the healthcare worker. We can't be careful. We have to take precautions as well. But another question came. This may work well for a nasal prong, but what when we are using a mask oxygen? A mask is already projecting about 4 centimeters from the face. You wear a surgical mask over that, there will be so much leak that is happening. So where should the mask be in relation to the oxygen? And this very interesting study, which was performed by having the surgical mask within the Venturi Hudson mask and surgical mask outside the Hudson mask, found that the difference in the FiO2 received by the patient was only a difference between 50 to 51 to 54, about 3 to 4% decrease in FiO2, which is clinically not too significant when someone is on moderate oxygen. So they said that those ones who are on mask oxygen would wear on top of the surgical mask, the mask which is delivering oxygen should be placed, and this would not significantly compromise the FiO2. So if we sum up that bit, it means that when a patient is on nasal prong, he should wear a surgical mask over it. When a patient is on a surgical mask, on an oxygen mask, they should wear a surgical mask within the oxygen mask, and the healthcare worker should wear full PPE. Going on to non-invasive ventilation, NIV is non-invasive ventilation, and it involves some terminologies which we will look at here. It gives one is PEEP. PEEP is positive end expiratory pressure. At the end of expiration, the pressure in the alveoli, which is the same as in the BPAP machines, we use the name EPAP, which is end positive airway pressure. The other terminology that is used is pressure support. This is more used in the ventilators. When we use pure BPAP or CPAP machines, the terminology actually that is used is the IPAP, which is inspiratory positive airway pressure, and the difference of the inspiratory and the expiratory positive airway pressure is the pressure support. I would be showing some pictures for you to understand this further. Now, the reason NIV is needed in COVID is two. One is to decrease the work of breathing. Otherwise, there will be patient's self-inflicted lung injury. Second is to improve oxygenation. And finally, possibly to prevent invasive ventilation. Now, this is a diagrammatic representation of EPAP and IPAP, but it also brings in some of the modes of ventilation. Now, you may be in hospitals which may be having BPAP machines. BPAP machines can come either as a S mode, S by T mode, or a T mode. S stands for spontaneous, and T stands for time. So wherever T is there, the machine is able, if you set a backup rate, the machine can deliver a breath at that particular time. Which means if a 12 breath per minute is set every 5 seconds, 60 divided by 12 is 5, every 5 seconds there will be a breath that will be given. Now this can be either, this is the EPAP, end positive airway pressure. When the patient takes a breath, there is a negative pressure that is realized by the machine, and it synchronizes with the pressure. Or if the patient doesn't trigger a breath within the given time of your backup rate, then the machine would by itself trigger a breath. And when it reaches to the top, the highest pressure is reached during inspiration is the IPAP, and the volume given during this process in relation to time is the tidal volume. Now again, looking at the same in a slightly different fashion, although the diagram show a straight line of PEEP and above that so much is pressure support, in real life it doesn't work that way. When someone normally breathes, there is a variation in pressure. And when someone is on CPAP, there is a variation in pressure. However, during expiration, it doesn't come down below the set EPAP. And when a bilevel PAP or a BPAP, the IPAP is given over the EPAP, and the difference between these two being the pressure support, then that would be the ventilation, and it would stop at where the EPAP is set at. So EPAP, IPAP, EPAP, IPAP, and this is the pressure support. This is how a BPAP machine functions. And in a CPAP machine, we would be setting only the EPAP, so that alone would be going on. There won't be additional pressure support. Going on to types of NIV modes, the pressure delivery and oxygen. This is important to understand because the way oxygen is delivered in each of this is quite different. First, let me look at a BPAP machine, which is a standalone regular BPAP machine. This you can set a EPAP, which is same as the PEEP, and you can set an IPAP, which is a combination of the EPAP and the pressure support. Now in this, we need to entrain oxygen. I'll show a picture subsequently. To the machine, oxygen is entrained. You have a flow that's going, oxygen is added to it. So from the wall oxygen or oxygen cylinder, up to 15 liter flow you can give. And that will give only a maximum FiO2 of 45 to 50%. You cannot go more than that. And this could further decrease. Suppose you increase the distance or the pressure difference between IPAP and EPAP, then because there is more pressure going on during inspiration, the mixing of the oxygen that you're giving will reduce, and it will result in a lower FiO2 than this. Next, you could have just standalone CPAP machine. Now CPAP machines give only PEEP, and you can either have a manual CPAP machine, and this is what is being used actually for obstructive sleep apnea. You can set at a particular PEEP and they give that PEEP. But the same problem remains, that you can only give oxygen which is entrained, which can be given only up to a maximum of 15 liters, which means a maximum of 50% FiO2. Now, there are some high FiO2 devices are there, which are produced by multiple flow meter within a device or multiple flow meters combined in series. So these can give FiO2s up to 100%, and in the expiratory limb, there is a PEEP valve with which we can increase the PEEP. So in effect, this works like a CPAP machine by giving FiO2 up to 100% and also giving PEEP to the desirable or set amount. Next, coming on to NIV mode of a ventilator. Now, if you have only a ventilator, you can choose the NIV mode of a ventilator. Now, the NIV mode of a ventilator gives both PEEP and pressure support. Here, pressure support is what is given in addition to the PEEP during inspiration. But not all ventilators have a CPAP mode. So suppose you don't desire to give pressure support and give only PEEP. If you don't have a CPAP mode, there may be an additional pressure which may be given by the machine because it is not tuned to work at CPAP mode. But because it is a ventilator, it has a blender within it, and you can give up to FiO2 of 100%. Going on to the interfaces. Interfaces is the device with which you give the pressure and the oxygen to the patient, which can be either CPAP or NIV. So it can be a nasal pillow, an oronasal mask, a full face mask which covers the eyes as well, or a helmet. Now the full face mask is not very popular because of pressures going into the eye and not much use. The nasal pillow is not used in this scenario. It's sometimes used in obstructive sleep apnea. So the main two modes we are concentrating on are the oronasal mask and the helmet. The oronasal mask is very commonly used. So people, therapists, doctors are more used to using it. But a very important message to take in these COVID times is we need to use non-vented mask. Now, what do I mean by that? Now, normally a mask which is used for NIV will have a vent, which is a expiratory release that happens close to the mask. Now, if that happens in COVID patients, it is going to bring out aerosolized virus particles into the atmosphere. So only non-vented mask which do not have that vent, or if you have a vented mask, you can use something to close it while using it for COVID patients. So how do you take care of the virus? You need a BV filter or a bacterial viral filter, between the interface and the exhalation port. We'll come to that shortly. Probably the safer way of delivering NIV is the helmet ventilation, but this has got its own limitations because it's not freely available and used as much that people are used to using it. But because it is contained within this helmet, there is a lot of safety for the healthcare worker, better patient comfort, and possibly decrease mechanical ventilation and mortality as well. Going on to indications for NIV in COVID. Now, it has been realized that anyone who requires more than 40% venturing would benefit from NIV to prevent them from progressing into a disease that can be tackled only by the ventilator. So anyone not achieving the 40% venturi on their targets, which we mentioned earlier, is someone who needs NIV. Then anyone who has increased work-off breathing, even with minimal oxygen requirement, is someone who's likely to go the pathway of SILI, self-inflicted lung injury, and hence early initiation of NIV should be considered. So considering for NIV should happen slightly earlier than this. Probably when the patient is on 35 to 40% venturing and doing all right or slightly worsening is when we need to consider referring for non-invasive ventilation or considering initiation of non-invasive ventilation. Now there are some requirements or prerequisites before initiating NIV. We need to do a chest X-ray to rule out pneumothorax, and we need that as a baseline before initiating treatment. We need an ABG at baseline to know the PF ratio, metabolic status. We need to have an escalation plan. Patient has gone this far. It's very important at this point, although however difficult communication may be, we need to take that on and make an escalation plan. Otherwise, if patient deteriorates, we wouldn't know whether the patient needs to be intubated, need to be sent to an ICU where invasive ventilation is possible. Now, there are some contraindications, though I have not mentioned here, is the usual contraindications of NIV. Low GCS of less than 8, someone who has got a facial injury, who's got an active upper GI bleed, these would be patients who cannot take on a NIV and would not be candidates for the same. Now, few tips for the NIV connection. Now, this is important. Normally, we may not pay much heed to this, but this is of paramount importance because we don't do this, we are exposing more virus particles into the atmosphere. Now we have to initially set the machine and the oxygen flow before we connect the patient, connect it onto the interface. And once we connect the interface onto the patient and secure it, only then we should switch on the machine. Otherwise, while we are connecting it, there can be aerosolization of the viral particle. And as I said earlier, there needs to be a BV filter between the interface and the exhalation port. Elaborating on that a bit further, this is a well-fitting mask, this is the BV filter, this is the exhalation port, and this is the entire machine. Zooming on this bit more, the mask comes out, oxygen port is there, this is the exhalation port, this is the BV filter. If we go ahead and put this BV filter beyond this, it defeats the purpose. Now the exhaled air gets filtered by the BV filter, and the filtered air goes out to the exhalation port and hence is safe for those who are breathing the environment. Going on to awake self-positioning or proning. Now the Intensive Care Society have given a position statement for a conscious COVID patient. Proning was found to be helpful for ventilated patient for many years in ARDS, and this is only the extrapolation of the same in COVID where people have found much benefit. I'm not going through the detailed evidence that is available, but it is well now documented that proning does help. So they put some guidelines as to how long, in what position, not just prone, you can go semi-prone, left lateral, right lateral and all. Just looking a bit on the physiology of how it works. Now, when a patient is lying supine, there is a lot of dorsal or posterior alveoli which is collapsed, and there is more blood flow in the posterior aspect. So there is more blood flow to places where there is more collapsed alveoli, and in effect there is ineffective ventilation, or there's a lot of VQ shunting that's happening. When you put a patient prone, the ventral alveoli which are having less problems with collapse, are now getting better ventilated, and now the posterior lung segments are getting recruited better, and they being perfused better improve the VQ mismatching. They also help in increasing secretion clearance. So this is the physiology behind awake self-positioning or proning, helpful in patients with COVID ARDS. So the indications as set down by these guidelines is anyone requiring a FiO2 more than or equal to 28% to maintain their saturation targets. If they can communicate and cooperate and are able to adjust independently, with maybe with minimal assistance, and you don't anticipate any airway issue, obviously you won't be putting this on someone who is eminently intubatable. So going on to the contraindication, anyone who is very tachypneic using accessory muscles, respiratory acidosis would not be a candidate. Someone is going for intubation, hemodynamic instability, low GCS, unstable spine, thoracic recent abdominal injury, surgery would not be candidates for ASP, as I would call it. Relative contraindications are facial injury, neurological issues, morbid obesity because they can't lie down on their tummy, pregnancy in second and third trimesters, and anterior dependent pressure source. Now, some practical considerations while I put up our respiratory ICU awake self-positioning protocol here. We need to remember that this is self or assisted. So if someone is not able to do it by themselves, it's not going to be materialize when there are 14 patients in an ICU who needs to be turned on a regular basis. So it needs to be maximum done by the patient with minimal assistance. Some positions may not be tolerated by the patient. So it may be useful to mention while we are mentioning this patient is not for left lateral position because he is likely to desaturate, or in the last time he was put there, he desaturated. Care of the tubings is required in ICU, and when patient NIV, a lot of tubings are there. When position is changed, it shouldn't cause disconnection and problems. And we should educate the patient about it. No, patients are coming with an intention to get well. They are desperate to get well. If we tell them that this is something which is going to change the outcome, they will be motivated, and that is the way we can make a difference. Then we put up this protocol which seems to be working well. So this is one of our patients whom it has been filled over the last 2 days, where we note the time and the saturation 5 minutes and at the end of position changing, and similarly the respiratory rate, what position and any remarks here. For example, this patient was sit up during this time and how the saturation changed and so on. Now based on this, we write in our doctor's order ASP. ASP without proning, ASP excluding lateral position. So it becomes mandatory for the nurses and our respiratory therapists to follow it. So it has been working, and this can be a thing that can be emulated in other places as well. Going on to some protocols, I'm going to concentrate on the oxygen therapy protocol and the BiPAP protocol, which are very important, from which others can be derived from. So when someone is indicated for oxygen therapy, that is less than 92 saturation normally, or less than 88% saturation when someone is having type 2 respiratory failure, we would initiate them on either a nasal cannula 1 liter or a venturi of 2 liter 24%. Then as they don't meet targets, we keep going up. Arrows are dual side, because if someone stabilized on a particular saturation target for 6 hours or more, we can come down on the oxygenation. Now when someone reaches and proning is initiated, encouraged very much at the beginning at 24 or 28% venturi. And at this point, escalation plans also have to be made. And if escalation plans are for full escalation or as NIV as ceiling of care, when they reach around 35 to 40, we need to actively consider them for NIV. Or even in 24, 28, if they are having increased work of breathing, they need to be considered for NIV. Now, if they are not for escalation to even NIV, then we continue on the oxygenation to go up to 40% venturi, 60% venturi, and a reservoir bag mask with 15 liters per minute. Now this is when a patient needs NIV, we initiate them on 15 liters per minute flow entrained onto a BPAP or a CPAP machine as by what is available. This is a protocol for the BPAP machine, and we start at a PEEP of 6 cm. Now the targets here are, because ABG is not yet done, that the target is a saturation of more than 92, and there should not be any work of breathing that is increased. So if the saturation is below 92 or there is increased work of breathing, we would increase the PEEP incrementally by 2 cm up to a maximum of 10 cm, because that is what is thought safe in a peripheral setup or a non-intubatable setup at the moment. Then at any particular PEEP, if the patient stabilizes, 30 minutes after the stabilization, there should be a ABG. Now, once we do an ABG, the third criteria of target comes in. So once we do an ABG, the target, as we saw in our literature, is 70 to 90 millimeter of mercury. So if they're achieving all three targets, saturation more than or equal to 92%, PaO2 more than 70, and no increased work of breathing, then we continue at the same PEEP. And now we initiated on 15 liters per minute oxygen. We titrate down the oxygen to target the saturation of 90 to 95. And then once we have achieved that, 4 hours later, ABG is done to target a PaO2 of 70 to 90%. Suppose even after achieving 10 PEEP, there is no stabilization of the patient from saturation or work of breathing point of view, this is probably the time we need to add on pressure support. Now this will be possible only if we are having a BPAP machine. If you're having a CPAP machine, we cannot go this way. We may have to consider going up slightly more on the PEEP to about 12, but that is at best what we can do. We may have to consider escalating to some other place where more invasive intervention is possible. But if you have a BPAP machine, then we can add on pressure support, and that would amount to, they are already on an EPAP of 10, adding on 6 of pressure support makes it 16 of IPAP and 10 of EPAP. And then the EPAP, the IPAP is increased incrementally by 2 cm of water to reach a maximum of 20 cm of water, or earlier it can be stopped if the targets are achieved. And at this point, we are looking at saturation target and no increased work of breathing target. Once that is achieved, again 4 hours later, we do an ABG, ensure our PaO2 targets are also met for best results for the patient. Now, this is just to re-emphasize that increment is 2 cm and normally made only after 30 minutes, because you need to allow some time for the PEEP or the pressure support increase to act within the system to result in clinical benefit. But if saturation is the driving issue, we may increase this faster than 30 minutes. So just to re-emphasize the targets of saturation, increased work of breathing, and PaO2. A few words on troubleshooting. You can either have excessive leak, a drop in saturation, or worsening respiratory distress. If there is a leak, we need to check for the tubings, where the leak could be, the fit of the interface onto the patient, or leak due to any part of the tubing or interface having a crack or opening. If there's a saturation problem, we need to first check the oxygen supply on the wall, whether the flow meter is running as in expected flows. We need to look at the tubings. We need to check if the interface is properly connected. Then we may have to increase the oxygen inflow or the PEEP. And then we need to look at clinical reasons for why the patient is desaturating. And suppose in respiratory distress, we need to look at SpO2 and leak and troubleshoot as above. And if we have to look at the machine, if it is working, a BiPAP or a CPAP machine, again, check the tubings, interface, and look for leaks. The weaning protocol that we follow in our respiratory ICU is, once they are stable for 24 hours, we on a particular setting of NIV, on the same setting, we decrease to 3:1. And by that, we mean 3 hours of NIV and 1 hour of venturi, which is appropriate to maintain target saturation. Then 24 hours on that, we make it 2:2, followed by 1:3. And 24 hours from there, patient is only on venturi. And after each step down happens every 24 hours, 24 hours on venturi, they are stepped down to what in CMC we call as a level 2 ward. Weaning from oxygen happens simultaneously, quite apart from this. Only the initial weaning, probably we advise not to do till the initial ABG is taken, so that you had an idea of the PaO2, the approximate PF ratio, and see how much you have to come down, and when you come down, you target your SATs, then subsequently PaO2 whenever ABG is done. Coming on to the cost, we discussed three things. Oxygen is very costly. Oxygen is costly. NIV is an investment. It is involved cost, but it remains with you subsequently. A ventilator is costly. A BPAP machine is about 1 to 2 lakh. A CPAP machine manual is around 40,000. A high FiO2 CPAP machine is around 1.5 lakh. We can custom make it by buying a blender, a PEEP valve and a test lung. Then it work around 1.2 lakh. The only thing that is very free is awake self-positioning, which can be done at the bedside and has got good results. Few quick slides on the current statistics we have from the 5-week service which we have for NIV exclusively in KICU. We completed 5 weeks yesterday. So far, we've had 106 admissions, and that was a 75% acceptance of the 141 referrals we've had. And the reason of refusing is because we don't have bed, because initially we had no device with high flow, high FiO2 possibility, so we had to deny a lot. The breakdown of the 106 admissions are 60 from the ward, that is those who are stepped up from a level 2 ward requiring NIV, 45 were stepped down when they are weaning off NIV to further weaning off in the KICU, and one was a direct receiving from the emergency department. And out of this 106, 14 are currently in KICU, 75 have been transferred out to the ward, 8 have been stepped up because they worsened to the ICU, and this is predominantly those who came from the ward were for full escalation and went up. 9 have died. Among these, 3 are de-escalation and 6 NIV ceiling of care. There was no death in anyone who was for full escalation. One quick patient, the 55-year-old male who came stable while he got admitted on the 15th. He developed respiratory distress, was shifted to a level 2 ward on the 17th. Very quickly, he deteriorated, and on 18th, came to KIC with a PaO2 of 38 on a 60% venturi. He was started on a 6 PEEP with a 15 liter per minute oxygen, and quickly he required full escalation and went up to 20 IPAP, 10 EPAP, 15 liter oxygen within 24 hours. So we were at the end of the road, and this was the worsening of the X-ray between 24 hours. We knew this guy was really going down. We had a chat with the family, and the family was not keen on taking him through, supporting him through critical care as to invasive ventilation. So we decided that NIV was a ceiling of care. He went on with 20 by 10, 15 liter for 5 days. But after that, from the 22nd, he gradually improved. He was gradually weaned. And then subsequently on 26th, was shifted back to a level 2 ward on 24% venturi with a PaO2 of 91. So that was one of the dramatic success stories we've had in KICU. Looking at the span over time of 5 weeks, the admissions, this is the total admission on top, admissions from step down from ICU and step up from the wards. Initially, we had more from the ICU because we were 14 beds were open, and slowly the ward patients picked up, ICU went down like that, ward step ups came up like that, and currently we have about 20 admissions coming in every week. The discharges from KICU have been either to the ward, the blue line, or step up to the ICU. Thankfully that is coming down, and those going to the ward have increased. These are the deaths we've had in KICU. The green ones are those on whom NIV was the ceiling of care, and red ones are those who were for de-escalation. And that was pretty okay. And in the last week, we've had encouragingly no deaths nor any shift out to MICU. And we hope that that would continue. We particularly looked at the 60 patients we received from the ward. 35 of them have gone back to the ward. 12 remained with us. 6 of them have died, but all of them NIV was ceiling of care. 7 have been stepped up to the ICU. There have been challenges in setting up a respiratory service. You need training of personnel. You need equipment. We need protocols in place, monitoring. We need to audit them and keep improving. We've edited our protocol at least 3 times in the last 5 weeks. We need to have appropriate referrals. Initially, we had referrals from the level 2 ward quite late with high FiO2, and we were not able to manage it because we didn't have high FiO2 devices. Currently, the trend has changed to early referral, and there has been more benefit. The current challenge we have is lack of high FiO2 devices. We have only a couple. So patients who require high FiO2, who may just manage with NIV, we are not able to provide high FiO2 because our devices can give only up to 50, most of them. But we are working on it, and hopefully we'll be able to get that as well. So I would like to conclude by saying that it is God who has been with us so far. We never conceptualized KICU. We were working on HealthMed, giving some NIV and KICU, and the need came through, and 5 weeks have gone through with all this that we have learned, and patients have benefited. But we believe that God's grace will take us through together as well. We don't know whether we are in the middle of the pandemic or somewhere close to 60-70% of the other end of the pandemic, but whatever it is, we can face it together, not with fear, but with faith, but because God is with us through it all. Thank you.
I'd like to thank Vani for taking us through this extensive talk on NIV and oxygen therapy. What we'll do right now is address some of the questions which have been put forth by the participants. I'll just read out some of the questions Vijay has asked. Won't the FiO2 decrease with increased flow with simple concentrators? So I request Dr. Bani to...
So if I'm understanding it right, with increase in pressure, won't the FiO2 drop? That's a question.
With increase in the... He wants to know whether with simple concentrators, with increase in flow, will the FiO2 decrease? When you're talking about the oxygen concentrators, that was the question.
With increase in flow, I'm not understanding why FiO2 will decrease.
What it should is, actually technically increase.
Yeah, when you increase the flow, FiO2 will actually increase. I don't know whether you wanted to ask, with increase in pressure, if you increase the pressure support or the IPAP, you're diluting the oxygen that's coming in. So when we reach 10 PEEP, what is the logic of increasing pressure support when someone is desaturating? So although increase in pressure would decrease the FiO2 by some extent, the increase in pressure support is increasing the tidal volume and hence is increasing the alveolar ventilation, which will improve the diffusion of oxygen over the alveolar endothelial membrane. So although there may be a slight drop in the FiO2, there will be an oxygenation that increases. And in effect, it may increase. So in some patients, it doesn't work. And that's why we go up to 20, and sometimes we've had to refer to MICU. And if done in a timely manner, it's no problem. Last 5 weeks, thankfully, we've not had to intubate one single patient in KICU. We've handed over to Dr. Bilila and team right in time to get intubated there.
So just to sum up what Bani said, I think essentially, I don't know whether the question was meant with BiPAP machines rather than concentrators, because concentrators, you increase the flow, you increase the FiO2. BiPAPs, you increase the pressure, you decrease the FiO2. I think with regards to masking, when you were talking about masking the oxygen device, there was a question from Sarah Uman, whether patients on mechanical ventilation or tracheostomy, is there a need for wearing a mask? So. I mean, I think I'm happy to answer that, yeah. Because so we do have these kind of patients are managed in the ICU, invasive mechanical ventilation, or even if you talk about NIV with a non-vented mask or tracheostomy, I presume your question is about wearing a mask, whether the patient wears a mask. So we don't do that. I think the patient wearing a mask will be only in settings where the patient's on, you know, nasal oxygen, nasal high flow. In all other situations, it's very challenging for the for a mask to be put for the patient. Anyway, the healthcare workers in these areas where invasive ventilation, tracheostomy, non-invasive ventilation is performed, it is advisable to wear N95 masks, visors, and hazmat suits. So that is what happens on the healthcare worker side. And there are more changes which need to be made, but I'll address that a little later with the next few questions. I think...
Can I just add, am I right that you use a closed suction?
Yeah, so with intubated patients, we use closed suction. But if the patient has a tracheostomy off the ventilator, we, you know, for those kind of patients, we don't really put a mask on top of the tracheostomy, because remember that when a patient coughs, the secretions will, you know, completely soak the tracheostomy, from the tracheostomy, the secretions will completely soak the surgical mask. And it's not advisable to put a mask over that. But as Barney said very correctly, patients who are intubated, got a tube in place, we try and minimize disconnections from the circuit by using closed suction catheters when they are connected to the mechanical ventilator. So, Barney, there was, I think when you talked about the protocol about doing ABGs, there was a question from Naresh who had asked about oxygen therapy. Can it be done effectively without doing ABGs? I think this is like settings where you don't have ABGs in place. What is your take on that?
Yeah, so where ABG is not available, using the saturation targets, you can go ahead and give oxygen therapy. As I mentioned, thankfully, the majority of COVID patients do not have a problem with type 2 respiratory failure. And if they have type 2 respiratory failure, that is hypercarbia, is because of underlying COPD, obesity, hypoventilation syndrome, and so on. So if you don't have that category, a normal, regular COVID patient, we are dealing only with type 1 respiratory failure. And you can very well manage with saturation targets of 92 to 95 and carry on giving oxygen and weaning oxygen.
Thanks, Barney. There were, I think, a few questions on structural modification, you know, on what is it? Sorry, can you see? On how do we protect the healthcare workers? Let's come down to the question, sorry. On facilities available in the ICU for preventing infection to healthcare workers. Can I just add a point? So essentially, I would just going back 6 months, when we started doing NIV, it was scary, it was concerning for us. In fact, actually, there was a sample of our N95 mask, a swab which was taken off the N95 mask and sent to the lab, and it was test positive for COVID, obviously, because there's a lot of aerosolization which happens with NIV despite using non-vented masks, despite using closed suction catheters. There's still definitely a lot of aerosolization which happens. So in CMC, what we went on to do, which I think should be possible in even smaller setups, we can put you in touch with our engineering and civil department here. They made structural modifications to the ICUs, where they use powerful exhaust systems which increase the number of air exchanges, and also HEPA filters were fitted into these exhaust systems. So these were the modifications which were made to the ICU. We actually do not have negative pressure rooms in any of the ICUs in CMC. So this structural modification has been done for most of the ICUs which are taking care of COVID patients. And as I mentioned earlier, the healthcare workers who are working in those areas, it is mandatory that you wear adequate necessary precautions and the protective personal protective equipment as is provided by your hospital. Important to wear headgear, footwear. If you don't have access to hazmat, even surgical gowns and visors and N95 mask is very important. So this is what we are doing here in CMC, and by God's grace, honestly, the number of staff, if I look at the number of staff in MICU who have become positive despite the amount of COVID that we've been dealing with, we've had about 350 to 400 patients coming in through the ICUs, and we've had about four to five staff in MICU who have become positive. Thankfully, all of them were pretty asymptomatic. So, Barney, I'll just ask you one more. So that was the question about the preventing infection for healthcare workers. So we just have one more question, which is a question raised by a couple of people on high flow nasal oxygen. And I'm not sure whether you're using high flow nasal oxygen in KICU.
So we are not using high flow nasal oxygen. One of the reason is the aerosolization that happens with high flow nasal oxygen is much higher than even NIV devices. So from that point of view, we actually haven't considered using that. I think even the two high flow nasal cannulas which were there in the medical ICU have been converted to CPAP devices rather than use as high flow nasal cannula per se.
So if you look at in MICU, what we have, you know, if you read literature actually suggests trying high flow nasal oxygen for patients. But there is a lot of aerosolization which happens. And, so, you know, what we find very strange is the amount of PEEP that can be generated with high flow nasal oxygen is just about 3 centimeters of water. And many of our patients who are severely critically ill, even with moderate ARDS, they somehow just do not tolerate it. They do not do well on high flow nasal oxygen. But yes, definitely there are centers which are using it. We haven't been using it very aggressively in our ICUs because we found that patients have not really tolerated very well. They seem to tolerate a reservoir bag better than a high flow nasal oxygen. So we have already kind of shot the time limit. Let me just see. Okay, so there is another question on if your patient has 88% saturation with respiratory distress and 88% saturation without distress, like the happy hypoxia, how do we proceed and how frequently do we encounter happy hypoxia?
So if I need to answer that, 88%, I mean, if you put it 92%, it would have been more difficult to answer. 88% by itself becomes indication for if that's on oxygen already, it requires NIV. If it's not on oxygen, it requires oxygen. And on oxygen, if the workup breathing doesn't get settled or the saturation is still low, they are candidates for NIV. So whether they're having increased workup breathing or not will determine how early or a bit later they can wait to be started on NIV. So if they do not have increased workup breathing, then we can very much wait till 40% entry and above to consider NIV. But if they have increased workup breathing, then they need to be started early. Happy hypoxia is about they being hypoxic but not realizing it. But when we are looking at it from an inpatient point of view, we are looking at hypoxia and workup breathing, and our decisions are based on that.
So I mean we have overshot time at this point of time. I think the recording of the presentation will be available and can be sent to you if you send in your requests to CCC training at CMC Vellore. So if there are any more questions, you can please forward the questions as well to us, and we will take your queries and answer them after sending it to the appropriate person. So I now hand over to Dr. Anand Zakre.
Thank you to Barney for that excellent presentation and a massive amount of work that has gone into taking care of COVID-19 patients, which has really enhanced the service. NIV is not only being provided in the KICU, but also in all the other ICUs as well, along with mechanical ventilation. But he's focused on the experience that they have had in their ICU. So I just wanted to tell you what other training resources are available at CMC. We have the handbook of clinical care management. We also have a self-learning module of 5 cases of common situations which are taking place on the floor, and I'm going to just show the links of that. The third is a town hall, which is a question answer session and sharing of experiences every Saturday between 9 and 10 o'clock. And there is a session tomorrow. The next Pulse lecture will be on COVID-19 and anticoagulation, which will occur in the second week of September, because next week is the MD exams here. And we will have weekly lectures after that. The dates and the time will be informed to you in a short while. So the links are there. We are trying to make the online module available to the mission hospitals. That's going to take a little bit of time. We request that any questions that you have, that you want to direct about this topic or any other topics in the area of COVID medicine, can be sent to ccc.training@cmcvellore.ac.in. and we will try and put it to the experts and to Dr. Barney and Vanilla so you can get some answers. So thank you to both of you, and I think we'll have to give a virtual hand to them, and I'm going to hand over at this point to Dr. Thomas Ram, Associate Director of Missions, who's also in charge of the training desk at the CCC.
Good evening. I want to thank all of you for participating in this inaugural series, and also all of you for being available to serve the needs of people affected by COVID-19. And the COVID Command Center, which has been set up at CMC along with various verticals, has been a dedicated center also trying to create various training modules, which Dr. Anand has just shared with all of you. And the training modules are constantly, and we are trying our best to see how it can reach out to as many of you out there in the mission network, also within CMC and out of our network. So at this point, I'd like to express my gratitude and appreciate the commitment of all of you for joining this session on behalf of the administration of CMC and the COVID Command Center training team. I'd like to also thank our resource faculty for this inaugural lecture series, Dr. Anand Zakaria for conceptualizing and creating this series, along with an enthusiastic team in the Department of Medicine, who in spite of their commitment in the COVID ward, have given the time to make this possible. Our speaker, Dr. Barney, for that excellent talk and the experience you shared, and Dr. Vanilla, being an excellent moderator and also sharing her experience from the ICU. Thank you both of you for making this evening very meaningful and relevant to our audience. Just like to share a brief piece of history when Aunt Ida, in a speech in 1922, in the first graduation, had mentioned that you will not only be curing diseases, but will also be battling with epidemics, plagues, pestilences, and preventing them. You know, little did she have realized that 98 years later, as we are remembering this year, her 150th birth anniversary, the same have to be repeated to the medical fraternity.